prime factorization is looking for factors, but it's more specific than that. It's looking for prime factors, so prime numbers which divide a given number. Let's start with that 30 that I gave you. Now many of you have said this, but we often use a factor tree for this. Here's what you do to find prime factorization. Now there's a couple ways to do this. I'm going to show you the easiest way to get things in order so you don't miss anything. The easiest way to do a prime factorization is to start with the smallest prime numbers you can find. Here's what you do. You all agree that these were the only prime numbers we had, right? Up through 50, that's it. So if this is all the prime numbers that we have up through 50, then all the numbers you're going to use are right here for you. You just have to find the ones that divide this one out. The key is, start with the smallest ones first and work your way down. Because it's all going to be in order for you when you write this in exponential notation, exponent notation, which we're going to do again. So first thing, we break that up. Can you tell me what's the first prime number that divides 30?
3.
2 does. So we're going to write this instead of 30 as 2 times 15. That's legal to do, right? Still makes 30. Now, as soon as we break off the smaller exponent, we're done. That's why we don't do something like 5 and 6, because then we have the 5 would be great, but the 6 we'd have to split up, it wouldn't be in order. So when we do the smallest primes first, it's already in order for us. You're going to see what I'm talking about in just a minute. 2, can I break up the 2 any further?
No.
How about the 15?
Yes.
We're going to write that in order. So 15 is what times what?
3 times 5.
Good. We check the next prime, 3 times whatever it is. 5 happens to be a prime. When you get primes at the end of your branches, so this is a tree, these are branches, at the end of your branches, you're done. What you do now, don't just leave it like this. You're going to write these ends, these leaves, we want to call them leaves, in order as a product. So what you say here is that 30 is... No, for a least common factor, you would have to have two numbers to find that out, okay? For right now, we're just doing prime factorization. I'll show you how to do this in combination with our greatest common factor in just a little while. We have two things, least common multiple and greatest common factor. Hey, is 2 times 3 times 5 the same as 30?
Yeah.
We write it in order, we have a prime factorization. What this is going to allow you to do, if you know how to do prime factorization, is simplify some pretty heavy-duty fractions without doing a whole lot of thinking about it. It's kind of nice. Let's try a few more to get the hang of this, then we'll talk about equivalent fractions, and that will end our day today. Sound good? Okay. Let's try 56. 56, so we start with our smallest prime numbers. We go down this list, does 2 divide 56?
Yes.
2 times what?
23.
20. 18. Not 18.
Only
19.
No.
Wait, no. 23.
Not 23. That would be 46.
28.
28. The 2's done. We go to the 28. You check again. Does 2 go into 28?
Yes.
Yes.
2 times what?
14.
You check again. Does 2 go into 14?
Yes.
Yes.
Listen, you're going to get the same numbers any way you do this, but if you do it this way, they're already in order for you, and that's pretty nice. You don't have to rearrange them at the end. So 2 goes into 14 how many times?
7.
How about 7? What goes into that?
Nothing.
Oh, that's a prime number. Here's what you do now. Now that you've worked with all your smallest primes first, you have a 2, a 2, a 2, and then a 7. What's 2 times 2 times 2?
2.
So 2 to the third power times what now?
7.
That's the way that you're going to write your prime factorization. If you do the smallest primes first, it will always be in order for you. Okay, I'd like you to try a few on your own. I'll give you 3 of them. By the way, will you get the same answer if you do something like 8 times 7? Or 7 times 8? Sure you will. Yeah. It just might not necessarily be in order. You might have a funky looking tree. Is that okay to get sometimes? Yeah, it's up to you. All I'm doing is giving you an option that you can use this and it will be in order every time. You understand the difference?
Yeah.
As long as you're able to get this answer exactly like that, I don't really care whether you do 8 times 7 or 2 times 28, and then 2 times 14, and 2 times 7. I don't care. But I'm giving you a tool that's going to make it in order for you. Nice, flowing, descending tree every single time, okay? That's one reason why we do that. I'd like you to try 60. And 256. Sorry, 252. Let's do that. Okay. Try looking for the smallest primes first. I'd left them on the board for you. So pretty much check 2 until 2 doesn't go into it anymore. After that, check 3. After that, check 5. Then 7. Okay, we're about to get going on this one. Let's look at the first one. We'll look at 60. Now again, I like to start with the smallest prime numbers just because I like it in order. It's just easier for me. So we're going to do, instead of 60, I'll write this as 2 times 30. I'm going to check 2 until 2 doesn't work anymore. So check 2 one more time. It works. That's 2 times 15. 2 doesn't work for 15, so I go to the next biggest prime number. That's 3. 3 does go into it. 3 times 5. 5 happens to be a prime number, so I know that this thing is completely factored out. All those are prime numbers. The ends of your tree have to be prime numbers. The way we write this, they're in order already. That's what's kind of nice about this. You just go, oh, I have 2 twos in a row. That means 2 squared. What's my next prime? There's a 3. Next prime, there's a 5, and you're done. That's why I like it in order. That way you don't have to look around for twos, okay? Because what you can't do is like 2 times 3 times 5 times 2. It doesn't work. It doesn't work that way. You have to have them in order to the powers that you have it. Does that make sense to you? How many were able to get that one? Perfect, that's fantastic. Okay, next up, try the 72. We're gonna do 2 times, so it looks like 36 to me. Then I keep going, 2 times 18. And then 2 times 9, and then 9, 2 doesn't work anymore, so I'm gonna do my 3. 3 times 3. And I see that I have a 2, a 2, and a 2. That's 2 to the third power. And then I have a 3 and a 3. They're in order. That's 3 to the second power. Did you get 2 to the third, 3 to the second?
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. Next one, 252. Oh my. 252. What'd you try?
2.
It's even, right? We know that's going to go in. You got 126? 126, good. Does 2 go into that one?
63.
Yes. That's kind of nice method where you don't really automatically know any factors, huh? You start trying until it's not even anymore, you just try 2s. 2 times, what was it?
63.
We've exhausted our 2s, that's not an even number anymore. Next thing we try would be 3. Does 3 go into it?
Yes.
I think so. I'm guessing most people did 7 times 9.
Yeah.
Okay. The back end of this will just be 3 and 3. You just have to make sure you put that in order, okay?
Then 21 would be 3 times 7.
It's fine to do the 7 times 9. I'm just giving you an option that notice how mine is completely in order. Yours probably does something like that, where you have a little extra off to the side. Not a big deal. Make sure at the very end you write this in order. So in order, I have a 2 and a 2. That gives me 2 squared. Next up, I have a 3 and a 3. That gives me 3 squared. And lastly, I can't forget about that 7. That 7 is at the very end. 2 squared times 3 squared times 7. And as a matter of fact, if you did that on a calculator or if you did in your head, that's going to make 252. That's the way we do that. How many people feel okay with this so far? Cool. Now, how we use this is with something called equivalent fractions. We're going to use this in combination with this, prioritization in combination with equivalent fractions, to be able to simplify fractions. Here's what equivalent fractions means. Equivalent fractions are fractions with the same value, but different denominators. So this would be equal fractions. But different denominators. Let's say you had 2 pizzas of the same size, okay? 2 pizzas, same size. One guy cut his slices into 5. One guy cut his into 6 slices. Sorry, his pizza into 5 slices. Another guy cut his into 6 slices. Another guy cut his into 9 slices. This guy ate all 5 of his slices. This guy ate all 6 of his slices. This guy ate all 9 of his slices. They're all the same size pizza. Did they have different amounts of pizza or not?
No.
Did they all eat their whole pizza?
Yeah.
They all ate the whole pizza. These are equivalent fractions. Notice how they have exactly the same value. They all equal 1. 5 over 5, 6 over 6, 9 over 9, they all equal 1, but they look completely different, don't they? Another example of this would be like, let's say you had a pizza cut into 2 slices and you had 1 slice. Okay, that's half your pizza. Or you had a pizza that's cut into 8 slices and you had 4 of them. Are those the same?
Yeah.
4 out of 8 is the same thing as 1/2, right? You had half the stuff here. This is half the stuff. These things are equivalent. This is what we mean by equivalent fractions. It's the idea that even though the values are the same, the denominators might very well be different. We're going to talk more about this next time. I'll show you how we use that to simplify some fractions. Did you understand today? Did it make sense for you?
Yeah.